Hello everyone, welcome back. Another episode of Bitcoin Trade here. I bet a lot of you have been experiencing some price depreciation. Price has come down off its 500. As you know, I got no fibs line or anything because it's broken to below 350 and back down to 300. As you can see, I'm on a BitPhoenix on a 3-day, the pullback here was not surprising. I've noticed that before the auctions of any Bitcoins, I see a price rise, and after, or the day before, or a few days before the auction, you'll see the price start to go down. So that's kind of been the scenario, but this is a little different, and I'll explain why it's a little different. First of all, this will be the last of the Silk Road auction, and then second is most of the auctions occurred during, let me see if I can pull back, occurred during this price going down. So, I think, was it maybe around here? I'm not sure. Somewhere around here, I think, were the first, some of the first auction coins. Which was, I think, it was around $600 at the time. And somewhere around here, probably the first. I'm not sure if it was here or. This seems a little too early. This seems like the first auctions, and then ever since then, the price would go up and then come down. Price would go up and then come down, just before the auctions would occur. Anyway, it just seemed that way. I witnessed a lot of the price movement before the auction. So, anyways, what it's a little different is, as you can look hindsight, and see that this was all the price was going down. Now that you're seeing something different, and this again, it's on a 3-day, and you know, once these trends. Or the average, I'm looking at the average specifically, once they start to trend, they seem to trend for a long time, and ever since this point, I've been watching the movements go above, and then go above again. It did dip down here, which was some concern, but at the same time, it was, it didn't stop me from trading, which I did get very inexpensive. Bitcoins at the time. The fear at this point was that it was going to go below whatever this price was, 262. The fear was that it was going to go below, 160. You know, and there was a lot of fear here. And then, slowly but surely, this started to appreciate in price, and so. A lot of times when you see trades or when you start trading, you'll see price go up and down, of course, that's natural. You just have to be careful of being too cautious sometimes. I did short a little bit just to gain a little bit more Bitcoin here. Of course, you know the price fell, but considering that most of the time I've been trading at this average, and most likely I'm probably trading at this longer term average here. So that was my average, which would be around 250. Considering it's 300, that's still pretty good. I'd be worried if it came all the way back down to 250, which would really suck. But again, I'm trying to get a sense of the overall trend, and the price has moved up. Going down, up, with a larger period of the average going above the 10 period average versus the, I think it's the 20 or 25 average. These are all weighted, and then it's coming down here, and this push up higher now. So if you look at this average, it stayed right around 250, while the 10 period average is getting up higher and higher, and sustaining a longer period of time and a larger distance in price of the duration, I guess, of this whatever time chart period. Anyways, my whole point is, yes, this was awesome. Going up to 500 was awesome. It does show that the price can go up above where it was. It also has come down, but it's come down to a point of where the price is right now, with 312, 300. We'll see if it can maintain that support. I think maintaining something above 300 is important. If it doesn't for any reason, then expect around 250 along this average. I'm not using the fib lines anymore because they just don't make any sense anymore. So when you're trading in whatever indicator or method you were using no longer works, you recommend pulling back and then reevaluating, looking at a larger picture. And so the larger picture, in my opinion, it still looks good. It still looks good. You're seeing several indicators that the price is wanting to push up, and it finally did push up. And having this pull back, the velocity and the ferociousness of how far it pushed up was a surprise for me. I was expecting mainly 400, and which, if you look here, it kind of, majority of the prices kind of just stayed around that area right here, and then finally dropped. I think this going up to 500 was, as you could tell by on the long term, this is a big wick. And so, anyways, which is, could be an indication of where the price is going, but not always. As you can tell, there's some wicks here, a little bit of wick here, a big wick here. So they don't always indicate direction of the price, but, you know, it did go up that high, and we have to take that into an account when you do a chart analysis. So, anyways, if you look here, you could kind of see the price evening out, and usually averages are lagging indicators, so they kind of lag a little bit. Now that the price has gone up, what's important is that it's starting to show a higher high and hopefully a higher low on the longer term here. And you know, for people who've gotten recently got in, you're probably freaking out. I've been trading since it, you know, 250 and then went up to 1,000 and then back down to wherever it is, 190, and then back up to 500. So it doesn't faze me a bit, just because I'm really expecting this thing to go up further in price as time goes on. Matter of fact, you could say, if you want to think about it, you can be an early adopter by looking at this price range here and how it's just so stable right here and it's going up now. That's the way I feel anyway. If you look, of course, if you pull back, you're not going to agree with me. Let me go to Bitstamp real quick. You're probably not going to agree with me based on what you see right now. And another thing I've noticed here is if you look at the price, you see they're very, very close. Very, very close. That means that, I'm not sure what it means. It could mean a few things. Prices depreciating, or prices going, those prices going down, because when Bitsy starts matching up, when Bitsy becomes the highest, you know, that's when you know price is going down. I have also seen in certain particular cases where Bitsy becomes higher and then everything else follows, which is really interesting. But that's not the case here because obviously the price is going down here. So for me, this is actually the perfect time to arbitrage. Wherever you need your Bitcoin to flow or your money to flow, and you want to take advantage of that opportunity in the exchange spread, I guess now would be a good time to do it. If you're a long-time holder, holding Bitcoins on a different exchange and just let the price of the exchange spread is a different, also a different way of playing your trade. It's a little bit harder to see the gains because you won't, you're not gonna realize those gains until you sell your Bitcoin or until you replace the Bitcoin that you sold at whatever price. Let me see if I can get it. Okay, so and I'll give you I think I mentioned this before, like HOBU, for example. If you look at the price of HOBU right now, that used to be higher than Bitfinex and by more than $10 at some point in time. Now you can see it's averaging out. So if you've been putting your money or putting your Bitcoin and selling your Bitcoin and buying, if you've been arbitraging and you've been using some of the Chinese exchanges to arbitrage, I'm thinking you have a scenario where, okay, you have money on these exchanges because obviously you sold to a Chinese exchange and bought on a Bitsy or Bitstamp or maybe even a Bitfin. You bought one of these because they're lower in price. You essentially have made a gain. Now that the price of these Chinese exchanges are going down or even at par or below at some of these, now you can start doing the opposite now, or you could wait until one of these go up higher than the Chinese exchange, and now you can start buying your bitcoins on the Chinese exchange and then arbitraging back into here if these ever go any higher. Another thing you can do is, I'm sure, what I mentioned before, is you can wait for this price to go back down. Well, not go back down, but obviously the price, you sold it at a higher price. Now that the price range has gone to par, you could buy back into Bitcoin using this exchange. You've got more money on this Chinese exchange with Chinese money to buy the Bitcoins because, remember, you arbitrage. So look at the price. It's 305, Bitfinex 407. So now you can go the other way with it, which in which you buy Bitcoins on the Chinese exchange, sell your Bitcoins on these other exchanges if they're higher, they're not, what Bitfinex is. Another one is now BitC, which is normally lower in price, is now almost par, even a little bit higher than Bitstamp. So arbitrage through BitC, basically you can really get a, for me when I see this, and now the price has gone down to 303. So as I see this, this is arbitrage opportunity. This is the point in time where, and it's typically the price going down. So you saw the arbitrage opportunity as the price went up, and you can see the spreads on the exchanges get further and further away. And then the arbitrage opportunity as price goes down, as they even out to each other, that's when you can reallocate your Bitcoins into these different exchanges or your money, and you're able to arbitrage without sending Bitcoin. You're just simply buying from one exchange and selling to another exchange, and essentially you transferred either Bitcoin or your money without ever sending any money. So once you get into that game, that's a whole different animal. It's almost counterintuitive to a regular trade often. Like on a regular trade, you buy, you know, when you think it's going to go up, and then you sell when you think it's going to go down, and then and you hope that you're right. Well, when you do arbitrage, it's really not about whether you think the price is going to go up or whether you think the price is going to go down. Really, your buying and selling signals on arbitraging on the exchanges is simply the price difference between all these different exchanges. And that's for the most part. That's I would say that's about all you're doing. I would say that's all you're doing. And I've already arbitraged and already positioned myself, so what you want to do is trade on all these exchanges as much as you can, and depending on the price between those two exchanges, it's similar to wash trade, but at the end of the day, you know, you got more bitcoins or more money on one exchange over another. So there is a gain to be made. It just doesn't show until the price moves again. So for example, the prices are almost all even. So wherever you did your arbitrage, here's your chance to basically arbitrage one more time to get back the value. And then of course let the price resettle again, and wouldn't be surprising that the price will go up again, and you'll see the same effect again where the spreads are starting to really widen out, and that's when you take the arbitrage opportunity. So it's a hidden way to make a gain, because it's not obvious. It's not obvious. The price will not, your trades will not show that way. Matter of fact, when you show it, or when you put it down on books or whatever, it kind of shows that, you know, you made a dumb move. You made a foolish move, because the money and the Bitcoin doesn't show until you re-arbitrage again. And only then will it show. But even then, it doesn't show, because then you have to re-arbitrage to get it where you want it. So that's kind of the issue with it. As far as me, you know, it does suck to see the value of Bitcoins go down. It's like if you had 100 Bitcoins and now it's 30,000, but it was 50,000. So you lost. You didn't really lose $20,000. You just never realized the difference, you know. But anyways, does it really matter? It's not like, I mean, I was not going to cash out all my Bitcoins at, you know, 50,000 or at 500, I should say. It didn't matter what the price was. I was not going to, for the most part, I was not going to, let's get this so you can see this a little bit better. Is that a little bit better? Okay. I was not going to sell my Bitcoin. If anything, I was going to use my Bitcoin, but wasn't going to sell, so, because I'm in it for the longer run. You know, I like to see what happens 2016 in January when it actually does start halving. Like, you know, the miners get half the amount of Bitcoin than they normally would. I'd really like to see. Let's see if I can get that to focus. Okay. I'd really like to see what is going to happen then. There may be some already price appreciation from it, but I think it's not over yet. I think, you know, once miners receive half the amount of Bitcoins, the price has to go up. Because they're going to receive half the amount doing the same amount of work. You know, at this current price, at 300, you know, they're not really getting 300 anymore. They're getting like 150. So they're back down here again. So a couple things are going to have to happen here. And we've seen some of that already happen in 2015, which was a lot of the cloud mining has ceased to operate. A lot of mining has ceased to operate, especially some of it, a lot of it. There's one major mining pool that left New York. I think they even ceased operation. So if you look at those things, if something has to happen, it just makes sense. Something has to happen. Either the price doubles, or there's going to be less miners out there, or less mining pools, less miners overall in general. So one of those are going to happen. So the number of miners has to decrease to fit to support itself, or the price literally has to double to keep the network going. So one or the other. I mean, that's the only thing that really is a good indicator or gives you a good indication of what's going to happen, I think. It just makes sense for me that way. Anyways, and based on that, I'm going to make my buying or selling of Bitcoins based on those factors. And that's the only hard evidence that, or any hard number that you can have in Bitcoin. I mean, you can look at the volume, you can look at the transactions, you can look at the price, you can look at RSI and all these different things. But in the end, the only thing that's going to, that's going to be true, that's going to be a fact, is that, mining is going to, the amount of Bitcoins that are going to be mined is going to decrease. And you know the amount, it's going to be half of what it is, so it's going to be 12.5. So if you're mining, whatever you're getting now, as far as money, because miners, I'm assuming, sell Bitcoins, you're going to get half of that next year. Actually, in about 6 or 8 months. You have to ask yourself, if I all of a sudden received half of the amount of Bitcoins average per monthly, can I survive? Can I pay my bills? Can I do this? Can I do that? Or do I have to shut down the operation? So either there's going to be less Bitcoins out there to fit the price, or the price of the Bitcoin has to keep up with the cost of mining. That's the hard information that I'm banking on or Bitcoining on. Will it happen? I don't know. I can only make that assumption based on past on the past, in which I guess you could say a couple things. This is 1 week on Bitstamp here. I wonder if it goes back anymore. Okay, it goes back that far. So basically, just look at the past history of this. And of course, that's not where we are. But what I'm saying is, what is that? $2.22. $2.22 in December 2012. That's what that is. If you can't, it's hard to see. You won't focus. And of course, this happened, and this is a time about the time of Silk Road, apparently. Of course, what's ironic is this is a strange thing. Silk Road was closed, shut down at that point, and you saw the price kind of depreciate a little bit, but all of a sudden it just started to rise up after that. And what was the reason for this? A lot of people speculate Mt. Gox and all this other stuff. And maybe so, but the fact is the price did go that high on many exchanges. So if all this was caused by Mt. Gox, why did it affect all the other prices on other exchanges? And it didn't. I think Mt. Gox was only like $200 to $300 difference. I don't know if that's a lot or a little, but obviously other exchanges didn't reflect that price. So, but it didn't mean. But obviously you see here, 1163 on Bitstamp. It still went up a lot considerably. Still followed this price trend. And so, sorry if this video is so long here, but now that I pull in this portion of it, you have to realize, like, sometime in the future, this will one day look like that. Or maybe this, you know. And so what I'm saying is, as time goes on, you're probably going to see more and more of this happening, where you're just going to get this very small growth. And I'm sure back over here during this time, when you looked at a chart, it probably looked just like this, like, you know, kind of like this. You know, went up a dollar, then went back down to 50 cents, and now it's trading at 20 cents, and, you know, it'll look just like this. And now, instead of talking dollar or cents, we're talking a couple hundred dollars. But again, if you just look at, and this is just my opinion, I mean, if you look at the past and you just watch it move and see it grow, you just have to ask yourself, at some time this stuff has got to move on that trend. Anyway, that's my opinion. I didn't sell. I probably won't sell. If anything, I've acquired a little bit more from a little bit short trading. I did buy above 300. Not a lot. Most of my gains have been through this period in time. Everything's around this right here going down. This is when I really started keeping my gains in Bitcoin right here. And I've been keeping my gains all throughout this year. You know, having it move up just a little bit more. And if you look on the weekly on Bitstamp, you'll see that it's still above the average, and it's moving up, I should say. So, long term, you know, when you pull back on a long time frame, it's really just a short little blip making its first move. I think there's going to be more moves in the coming days and months. You just have to let it unfold. That was a nice ride. I did enjoy it. It was nice to see the potential of how much your Bitcoins can be worth, especially when you've been trading down at this trough right here. I think if anything, it should encourage a lot of investors and traders who have already been trading. Since if you've already been trading, then this price going down, this recent price from 500 that went down, is probably nothing to you. It's probably something that you're like, okay, I recognize this as the first wave, or maybe the second wave, who knows. But it's a wave that's coming, and it's pushing up instead of pushing down. And so hopefully, if you're smart enough, you'll recognize that, and you won't be jaded or disappointed in the recent price going down, because hopefully you'll be able to see the bigger picture and see that it's just starting. Actually, some people are really happy the price went down, because now they could just, they know that it's been to 500 recently, and so if it, people are willing to buy it at 500, you know, from 2015, this low trough area, that chances are people are, will continue to buy it, pushing the price up, hopefully further up to the 600 point. But we'll just have to see. It's just one of the things where you're going to have to let time unfold, unfortunately. Anyways, let me cut out, and I will try to cut in and see how the rest of this week progresses. But that's my opinion, that we're just in a correction in the price. It's still going, still hasn't reached its low yet, but it's getting close. 3306 is on Bitstamp. But if you look at this, you'll see it's kind of looks like it's reacting to that 10 period average. That little white line right there. And so, you know, it's still too early to say that this rally is dead, because I'm trading on a weekly basis now. You know, I don't even mind the daily movements, mainly because I've gained so many Bitcoins during this low trough area that I'm still up, even though it's come down $200 from $500 being $300. That was kind of weird to say, but I'm still up, if that makes sense. I'm still up, so there's reason for me to keep holding. Even if it was 500 right now, let's say if it was 500, I still would not sell my Bitcoins, because I'm not going to sell until it reaches another all-time high. And I'm talking about above 1160, whatever this price is. You know, when it gets to 1,000, that's when I'll start thinking about maybe selling. But really, if anything, I would start selling when it starts making all-time highs, making a new all-time high, and then making a new all-time high. That's when I would, I guess, start selling. And I wouldn't sell all at once, because I would be trying to do it in a way where, since I don't know where the top is, I would try to just sell a little bit after it reaches the top, and then give it some time, at least another 24 hours, and then watch it, and then during that 24 hours it makes another high, I would sell just a little bit at a time. But until it reaches at least 1,000, I wouldn't really sell. What I would do is I would wait until I thought the right moment was right. You know, 300 is starting to really look good, just because of the fact that on the long term, if it does continue up higher, there's a good chance that it's going to ride that 10 period average, which it normally does. So anyways, let me cut out, and I'll cut back in, and we'll see how the price goes for the rest of the week. Hey everyone, I'm cutting back in, and I'm going to probably just cut back in and go out really quick. I just want to say this real quick. I'm noticing that Bitsy and all these other prices were almost the same. Now they're starting to see some difference in price here on Bitsy, and Hobo's really come down quite a bit, almost under sometimes. But pretty much you're seeing these three right here almost par, and then Bitsy's pulling behind a little bit. So So, you know, that's one of the things I was talking about, arbitraging, just moving your Bitcoin or your money to a different exchange. Let this exchange settle on what price it is, and between the difference in each other exchange, you can ideally gain in Bitcoin ultimately, but you can also gain in money as well. So just kind of showing that it's starting to normalize here, I think, to a settled price, which is around 300, which is good, because I think that means that it's 300 has become the new floor, so to speak. And I guess from there, I did make some lines here, and basically the end of this week we'll find out whether 300 is the new floor. Today's Wednesday, so by Friday, and maybe it up to next Monday, we'll see if 300's the new bottom, and from there you can build on top of that. So anyways, let me cut out. I just want to cut in real quick, because I just noticed this, the price really stabilizing here. So anyways, I'm gonna cut out. Hello everyone, welcome back. Just cutting in. Got some interesting price action so far. I've redone the fib lines. This line from the highs from here to actually this top point, because I want to see if it's going to break above this fib line at 343.32. This is actually I redrawn the fib line. This is 299.64, which is almost close to 300. It reached the low of 302 or something, 301. Or close to 300. It's moved around and it's hit up here. I'm on a 4 hour just to fit this in. It's a bigger fib line, it's a bigger triangle. Let me see here. The other thing I want to talk about is the prices. It did come back to par with everything, and now it's starting to stratify again. You're seeing Bitstamp at 333, BitC at 330, BitPhoenix at 336, HOBO at 338. So not as much spread as before, but it's starting to spread out again. When it got down to 300, it started to balance out. Everything was about 300. I think BitSet went out to 299 almost. It dipped below 300 for a little bit, but it kind of hit here, and then it's moved up, and it's moving up on this fib line right here. And so we'll see what happens. That's why I put the line on top of this, even though it's not finished. I have a feeling that this is going to be a resistance here. So if it breaks through above that, then you know, we'll see what happens. So far it's from here to this top, got me to here. I moved the line to 2 points from here to here, just to see if it's going to break out, or if it's going to push the price down. There's two supports right here and here again. I've also redrawn those lines out. Let me see if I can get you a better idea what the lines are. Okay, this is on the 12 hour on BitPhoenix. As you can see, BitPhoenix price. And let's see if I can even shrink this a little bit more. Okay, so one line going from here to this pivot point here, and it's following this lower path. The other one is from that pivot point to this bottom right here. So that's kind of where I'm getting the lines here. Let's go back to a 4 hour. And there we go. So, so now I think I got, again, I'm on Bitfenix 4-hour. I'm just trying to make this proportional to the fib line that I made, and you'll notice that this is 70, so the fib line starts at that pivot point that I was talking about earlier, and goes to the top of this, obviously, and here's my line drawing it out, and so the price has already reached this point right here. If it can push up high and go above 240-ish and break out of this, it's possible it can't. But the way it's really reacting. I would say, let's see how it reacts to this line, because the fact that it just moved and stopped at 340 and then is pausing, it's gonna take some time. But I'm on a 4-hour, so every candlestick is about 4 hour. You kind of have to go in and out of these time frames until they kind of sync up with, I guess, your chart. Anyways, that's just a quick overview. We still got a long ways to go. Let me cut out, but I just want to point that out about the prices starting to stratify again, and they're stratifying upwards, not downwards, of course. You see there's a spread of $60 between Bitfenix and Bitsea, about $1. So Bitsea and Bitstamp is kind of pairing up really closer, and Bitfin and HOBO starting to pair up really closer. But you're starting to see some stratification going on now. So anyway, let me cut out and cut back in later. Hello everyone, I'm cutting back in here, and I've drawn out some lines. I've let the price kind of move around so I can get a better idea of how to map the chart and how to do a better reading. Reading charts, if you're gonna speculate and you're gonna trade and you're gonna be buying and selling Bitcoin, it helps to read charts, especially if you're trading Bitcoins. But anyways, I guess I'll back out and like maybe do a recap here of. So I've totally mapped out this whole chart and everything. Mainly, you're not going to see this. I think you have to pull back. I'm going to pull back maybe to a 6-hour. There we go. Okay. So let me just pull back to a 6-hour and give you a better idea what's happened. So basically, the top and the bottom right here, I'm making a line from this to some pivot point right here, and then a larger, actually from this low to this pivot point comes out to this bottom line. This line that actually touches the candlestick here, that's from this point to this point, shooting on going down further. So anyways, that's the overall picture. So from that pivot point, I've drew up a fib line, and I'm just doing that so the chart makes sense, reading the chart makes sense. There's some correlation to the past here from this pivot point down here. As far as some of these, it kind of does make sense, and some of it doesn't make sense. I'm really looking for this past part right here, the movement in price here, and how it's moving around now. So this is a longer term fib lines here. So, but let's go back into the 1 hour, because I kind of like looking at the 1 hour because it's more detailed in time. But again, pull back if things are not working out. Okay, so let me pull up. So anyways, I made this line several times from here shooting down, and it did look like it was going to break out, but it didn't break out. Then I drew the line from here to here, which when it crossed here, it looked like it broke out, pushed above, but came back down. Now, when I draw these lines, I just keep drawing the new high and the new high like I did here. And what I'm really waiting for is to break out of this fib line right here, which is about 240. You can see several times it's jumped above 240. I'm sorry, 340, and then again at 340 here, and then you see that it's pushing. And as I zoom in, you know, I got a longer support line right here, which I've shown you. That's what that looks like, and this is the resistance here. So after a while, it makes a pretty good. After a while, I see some kind of pattern here where it's trying to push up higher on the fib line of this 240. I'm sorry, 340. And then how it's reacting to it along with this new downward trending line here. And you see it's kind of bounced, it's come down, and then it's bounced up, hitting up against this line. That's because I put that line right there. So anyways, it does kind of correlate because you see a small little resistance here. To get a better idea of where the price moved, you won't really know until you come very close within a in my experience, 2 to 3 hour, maybe sometimes on the hour of when that price actually moves. Most of the time, sometimes it'll just drift for a while, so that's when you got to step back. But I'm back to an hour. I'm trying to get a better idea of view of this. And it looks like it's following this trend line, and I'm waiting. I finally had enough information has been going on, enough price action has been going on for me to draw a support line, a very short-term support line on a 1 hour. Remember, this is 1 hour on a BitPhoenix, and there is the current price, 332. It goes up to 333. I'm going to be waiting here. It's about two. Maybe 3 to 4 hours between this point in time here. Matter of fact, let me just get an idea what time frame we're looking at. Let me see, Friday. Let me see, that is 3 o'clock Friday. Well, today is Friday, and it's Friday the 13th of all days. So I don't know if that's going to play into trading, maybe, maybe not, who knows. Anyways, I'm going to wait for this time period, or I'm going to see for what's happening. What I'm trying to see is if it breaks above the 340, if it breaks out of this, like genuine breakout, because it looked like it broke out here, but it didn't. It looked like it would broke out here, but it didn't. So I'm looking for a genuine breakout, and not only does it have to break out, but also has to cross this line and finish above it. That's when I know things may start to go back up, start trending back up. It's obviously been, in my opinion, oversold. Interesting enough, this line, this trend line right here, which is the point between there and my, what I call it, focal point, or... I don't know, wherever I have it, it bounced up from there and then came down and actually bounced off of that support line, shooting up to this fib line, which I think makes a lot of sense now, after I let the price move around a little bit, and you see it's kind of, wouldn't break quite above it, but at the same time, it wouldn't fall below the price either, and so that's when I drew this short-term support line, and then we're getting into a squeeze position here, so we'll see what happens. Let me cut out. All right, everyone, I'm cutting back in, and just wanted to show this part right here where it's that's the current price, BitPhoenix. It's gone up a little bit since it's hit the bottom right here, and this is just 1 hour. So it's testing that resistance, and I just kept redrawing the line, and I redrew the line from here all the way up to the 500 mark, and because you just gotta redraw it every time it makes this top and doesn't push up through. If it can break through here, then see if it'll hit 2340. Since it hits 3340 and it stays above it, we'll see if this trend going up will continue. So that's what's going on. So let me just a quick cut in. Let's see if it does happen. I'll cut in when that does. Hi everyone, I'm cutting back in, and it's about that time, and it looks like there was pressure building up, and it did pop through, but that doesn't mean anything because it still has to reach this fib line here to do anything. So there's the current price on Bitfin, and it's small, but we'll see what happens. I was just cutting in just to see that. Of course, I just have to remove this line up again after the hour is over. One thing you want to make sure when you follow candlesticks and lines and everything is make sure that this is finished, a finished candlestick, before you get into a trade. So let me cut out and I'll cut back in later. All right, everyone, I'm just cutting back in just to show, which kind of looks like it is moving upwards. I had my original line here at this high point going down, and it looks like this previous candlestick showed that it was moving up. I did move the line again on top of this candlestick, the previous candlestick, to see if the next candlestick would go beyond it, and it did. So it looks like it's going to move up higher. Now all it has to do is move above this fib line right here, and we may see a break up to this higher fib line, which is at 374. Yeah, 374. And so almost to the estimated time, which it actually started right around what here? Right around here, 14, 15. Let me see, where's 15? That's 16, and that's 15. So yeah, Friday 15, looks like maybe it started around that candlestick in particular. This previous candlestick right here. Because when I put my line originally, it was down here, and this was the candlestick that broke. But we'll see, it still has to pass above this line, and that is 243.32, looks like. 243.32. I don't know if you can see that. That comes out any better. But if it moves and stays above that, it's definitely following this trend here, this short little trend. And I would expect if it does that, it would go up higher, up to at least 374, as it said. So we'll see what happens. I'll try to keep up to date on that. So let me cut out. All right, everyone, I'm cutting back in, and there's the current price. It did hit up to four. Let me see here. What price did it hit up to? Right here. Oh. So the high was 343.75 right there, and as you can see, that it did react to that fib line, at least on an hourly. It did show that it was breaking through. Actually, it was breaking the candlestick right before that did break through, and just to give you an idea, I mean, it's not going to make you it could make you a lot, but for someone to make a market order, that would push the price up. But let's see, it's 333. It was there for a very long time, to all the way up to wherever that was, 330. So that was, it was 433.73. Anyways, that was a $10 move right there within an hour. And for someone to have 100 coins or if you bought 100 coins, which could be possible on Bitfenix because you see a lot of market orders, or how about 10 coins? That's 100 bucks in an hour. Not too bad. 1,000 coins, now you're talking about $1,000. So, anyways, small little trades like that, it's possible. In order to do something like that, you may have to do a margin trading, leveraging yourself to buy $33,000 worth of Bitcoin to make $1,000. It's not really worth it, you know. So, but I'll just give you an example. I pretty much did a trade on that just to do it. I made about $1. I bought like 0.1 Bitcoin and sold it up here, just like in the fib line that the price it gave me. Yeah, that's the stop price I put, and I made about $1. And so, if this works out, I may just do a lot of short-term, very short gain trading to make either a quick buck or a quick Bitcoin, one or the other. So, anyways, let me cut out here and let's see how it goes out and then it unfolds, because it might push up higher than here if it could finish above. So let's keep track of this. All right, everyone, I'm cutting back in, and I'm on Bitfenix 1 hour, and some time has passed, and you can see that it's starting to break down to the original price. So I made a small little buy order. Have it hit up here, had a limit sell order, and then it came right back down. It's actually breaking right through the support line, which is really a short support line. So I have to redraw it again to attach up to here, and well, it should give me a different time frame here. So it didn't break up. My plan was basically to buy, sell when it hit here, and have it go up, and then once it kind of finished up higher, I would buy again and put a sell order here. Now these are very short term, very small amounts of Bitcoin trading. I'm already positioned long. I'm just trying to take advantage of these larger moves that we're getting. You know, it's moving, you know, $30-$40 in a 24-hour period. So you can definitely a $10 move is definitely easy to do. So, anyways, I'm gonna keep watching it. I'm gonna have to redraw this line and all that, and then see what other new time frame comes up. But anyways, let me cut out, and we'll just keep going with it. All right, I'm cutting back in, and this is the candlestick that moved up and hit down, and it's made another low for this trend line, so I had to make another point from here to up here instead of here to up here where it was originally, and just made a small adjustment. It's not uncommon as you get closer to the time where it might make a move up again or it might start breaking down that you have to make a small adjustment towards the end. I did that with this line as well. Made another line after it reached here but came back down. I got a new time frame, which I'm about an hour or two before it hits this area, and as you can see, the price is slightly moving up. I didn't take any position right here, mainly because there's not enough room here for me to be excited about. Maybe here, as you get into these triangles, the best time to really make the move is actually right when it's initial first or second bounce from the bottom, After that, it just becomes a little smaller, as you can see on this particular 1 hour chart, still BitPhoenix 1 hour. And here's the current price on BitPhoenix. So anyways, it looked like it was gonna go up. I just wanted to cut in just for that and give it another couple hours to see if it goes up or down, and if it does, will it break this? And so so that's what I'm gonna just wait for, and so I'll just cut out right now. Alright everyone, I'm cutting back in, and I moved the lines a little bit to the more recent price activity. As you can tell, I made a limit order here and put a stop order here right at this fib line, right around this time. It looked like it was going to go, but it stopped, so it's definitely reacting to this fib line here. It's come down, and I thought I was going to break just a little bit, but no, that's not the case. It touched up against this resistance, which I had at this point here in the top of the high, but it never really broke through. As you can tell, I redrew the line so it fits a little bit better, but in any case, it hit up, and then it just is dropping now, and every time I'm drawing this portion of the line, every time it makes a low that fits within this line, and so it's starting to fall down. I don't know how far it's gonna fall. There's another support right here, which is on the long term, and so there's a lot of things that are happening within this few time frame here, which is going to be let me see here, looks like there's a two intersection right here, which I'm going to wait till, what is that, Saturday? Sunday, 1800 hour. So let's see what happens here after drawing this more recent line, because it was touching up against right about here, and then right about here, and then it just hit down. So it did reach that time period, and it went down, as you can tell. And that's the current price. I want to also talk about the price on each exchange. They're starting to stratify. They break even at one point, and then they stratify out, and then they break even, and sometimes Bitfin and HOBO are about the same price, and then other times Bitstamp and BitC were about the same price, and then at one point they're all about the same price. So you see a lot of things going on. When I saw that, I'm noticing consolidation going on, or slow downward price when things like that happen, when they start all becoming par to each other. So there's a lot of things that are going on here. Obviously the volume has been lower. The RSI's stayed around 50, sometimes dipping down towards 30, sometimes dipping up towards the 70. So it really hasn't done a lot. It's just, it almost seems like what it did before in the 380 area, where it just jumped up and then just slowly just kind of just worked its way down. We'll have to see. There's a lot of things going on right now. And the prices are moving a lot more per day. They're moving like $10 to $20 per day, instead of, you know, your $2 to $3 a day that it used to be. So I'm going to see how long this fails to move above this. If it starts to really creep down here, there is this little support here, but if it retests this 300, the 300 may not hold up, so we'll just have to see. So I'll just cut out, and I'll probably make one more cut in, and then upload this video. Hello everyone, welcome back. This is going to be the last cut in here before I make a new episode. Anyways, the price has been going sideways for a very long time. This is kind of where I made my long position and sold short on this on the green candlestick, and then on the red candlestick, that's where I sold at this fib line right here. And since then, it's never really come back. And so my strategy was, okay, I've seen it go up and hit this fib line several times. On the last one, when it broke out of this, when I drew the line from the from 500 to this point right here, it looked like it was going to break out, and it did, but I wasn't too sure that it was going to break out. And I sold, put a limit, a sell order on this fib line, and I figured the next time it does that, if it does break out, I'm not going to really buy again until it goes above the fib line. And this is on a BitPhoenix 1 hour. These are the current prices. As you can see, the prices has dropped down. Here you go, BitPhoenix, and that you'll see that it is running live here, and that's the current price. And it just bam went down. Now I'm not sure what happened. A lot of things has happened outside of the Bitcoin world. I don't know if anybody knows this, but Friday the 13th, apparently that day there was a terrorist attack in France. As I woke up this Sunday, I always look at the news, and it turns out that somehow Bitcoins are involved in this terrorist attack. I don't know if that has any effect to it. I doubt it, because the price did not just dramatically fall like it has been. And again, I think that's also a lot of propaganda. I don't know, it just seems so weird. Anyways, I don't know if this is has any reason for it, other than the fact that it was just going sideways and never able to push up above this fib line, and it just decided to just, you know, let go, and it did bounce down. And I did put a order in, another limit order, if it did decide to break down. And it basically was based off of this kind of scenario, this fib line scenario here. Remember I told you there's waves within waves? Well, there's some similar waves. This scenario fits between the larger fib lines from the 300 to around 342 or 343, somewhere in there. So this fits within a fib line. So as I drew it up, there is a possible another limit order around here, around was that 312? If you want to be more exact, 312 and 30 cents. And as you see that it is approaching this support that you see here, that is slightly going up. That's a longer term support here. And so there is a limit order there, but I did not do that on this particular exchange. So I actually do have a Chinese account, and it is on Hobu. I actually have all trading accounts on all these exchanges. So mainly because I use Bitcoin Wisdom, so they're right there on the prices. I see them as I'm trading. As you can see, the Chinese exchange has come down lower, and which is great if you've been arbitraging towards the Chinese exchange, and even taking advantage of the higher price. Now it's starting to really pay off for you. This is where arbitraging really pays off for you. Pays off for you if you've been arbitraging, not really the price through the different exchange, but through the spread of the different exchange at that time. So it was $60 spread between these other exchanges. At one point, now you see it's coming down under, and sometimes Hobu does go, the Chinese exchange does go underneath the other exchanges. And so that's kind of how I arbitrage. I don't really, you know, arbitrage in the sense that I transfer my bitcoins buying at a lower price and selling at a higher price and then somehow cashing out. What I do is I just buy more Bitcoins through the arbitrage. So the money made through the arbitrage, I just get more Bitcoins. So anyways, there's this thing right here, which I guess if you had some limit orders, you could have put some in here just in case. There is another chance that it could bounce up and break up now that I got another long-term trend line here. And so it's going to be squeezing in here. 310 is probably where this price is going to head to slowly. And then from there, we'll see if it bounces up. But it's still in this FIB range. And I'll give you the... I'll just back out here. And, okay, this, oh, okay, disappeared on its own. Okay. Let's back up to a 12-hour. And this is just on Bitfenix, so... And here's my overall chart here that I've done. I'm still waiting for the retraction from the pull down here, but anyways, let's just... Oh, my mouse got stuck. Anyways, there's my focal point, or my pivot point right there, and then the two trending lines. Let's see if this will move out of the way now. Okay, great. So there's my two trending lines that I overwent, and there's that first one that you see, and you see this is kind of going and then pushing down on here. I'm still waiting for the push back up. So this is a retracement going down. Now I'm trying to find out the retracement. Okay, after it retraces, if it's still going up, it should bounce here, because I'm not seeing, I think there's still a chance to push up, maybe not beyond this, but push up within these ranges, from this range to this range, which is about 300 to 400, so it's a $100 range now, so we're working within the $300 to $400 range, or $300 and $450 range, because of a couple things here. I haven't seen... usually when you see a pullback, you'll see another push up and then a pullback again if it's really headed down. All I've seen is this thing keep going down and down, like down and a little sideways, down a little sideways, and then it's not going down anymore. Well, we'll see. The point is, I'm not seeing a move up like you typically do and then a push down further down. So I'm anticipating an actual move up from coming down. So I mean, it's going down, and I'm anticipating a little push up as it breaks out of that, and then if it does continue to go down, then it'll go down further, but we'll have to play on that market. So if you're in a unique position like someone I am, what I'm doing now is I'm actually truly speculating. I'm literally just picking a place that I want to buy. And then I am literally a day in or night trader or whatever. Once I have my limit orders put in and they hit, they often move. So they move pretty quickly. So either I have a buy order and then I set a sell order, or I have a buy order ready for the price to come down, and then I either put a sell order in on a market order, or I actually put a order in for a limit sell. And so that's kind of what I've been doing now, because the prices move a lot more. You know, before here, they were moving maybe $1, $2, $3, $4 a day. Now they're moving $10 to $20, sometimes $30 a day. And so if you, that's the kind of moves that I like to see, because I can pick a price where I want to buy in and then pick a price where I want to sell, or where I want to sell then rebuy in. Vice versa, and I use that mainly with the fib line. So Overall, on the 12-hour, this is on Bitfinex, on the 12-hour, I'm looking at this thing and I'm going, well, I see the pullback, but usually on the pullback, you also see a push up, and if it's continuing to go down, like I know a lot of people have fear that this is just going to go back down. Well, if it does continue to pull down, it needs to go up one more time and then push back down again, and that's how it usually works. So I'm still waiting for the push up. Now that I know that maybe there's a chance to push up, I got to figure out where I want to put my sell orders. So I want to figure out where I put my buy orders and where I put my sell orders. And the great thing about the strategy I'm taking is it does a couple things, okay? Alright, first of all, it allows me to speculate, so I really am speculating at this point. And it allows me to take a little bit of risk. Now, I'm not doing a lot, I'm just doing 0.1 Bitcoin at a time. So I buy 0.1 Bitcoin, I sell 0.1 Bitcoin. And what I'm really doing is I am making a gain in US dollars. But the point of making the gain in US dollars is to eventually buy into Bitcoin at risk-free. So the gains I make for the US dollars, I put back into Bitcoin and it's risk-free. So I can let it float and not worry about it. The reason why I'm doing that is the price seems to be going down. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to, you know, using the fib lines as marker points, mapping my chart out. I'm putting in strategic buys, and I'm not buying at any point in time. I'm buying at a particular point in time, and this is where the lines come in. You have to keep drawing the lines out to get a better idea where it might start to break out. I might have to start focusing on the longer term on my bigger order limits. I'm going to use the 12-hour because I'm in that range of 12 hours here, and this is my fib line for the 12-hour. For a shorter term, and I'll go on to a Chinese chart now, a shorter term you can do is, now this is Hobu, 1 hour, and here you go. And what I like about Hobu is that it's commission free, so there's no commission to be paid on this. So whatever you order, you order one Bitcoin, you get one Bitcoin for the price of that rate. So as far as speculating goes, I'd highly recommend Chinese exchanges. If you're doing something else like arbitraging, you need all the exchanges. If you are doing peer-to-peer trades, I recommend you do all the exchanges and somehow fund those exchanges, either you know, with Bitcoin itself, or if you can you know, somehow wire funds or transfer funds into your account, do that and have a little bit of Bitcoin money on all exchanges, and let them float, let them both float, and that way you're making the gain on, you know, the fiat currency side and the Bitcoin side, making gains on both sides. Eventually, what I recommend is not even bother with wire transfers coming out of the exchanges. Just take the Bitcoin. Don't bother with that, trying to get money through the exchanges. I'd actually recommend not doing so. Because the whole point of this is everybody starts out with having some fiat currency. Well, everyone always starts out having fiat currency. The point is for everyone to end up with Bitcoin. So that's the point, right? Everyone has fiat currency, but not everyone has Bitcoin. And so when I came into this, I wasn't here to get more money. I was trying to do this to get more Bitcoin. Because I mentioned this before, I'll say it again, you have money, which is an unlimited supply, all right? And what you're buying is something that is a limited supply. And, you know, logic kind of dictates to me, or I think I like to think I'm a pretty logical kind of person, but maybe I'm not, that a unlimited supply will go down in value and a limited supply will go up in value. So as you're converting from a unlimited supply into a limited supply, the price of the limited supply, which is Bitcoin, will go up over time. That's just, you know, my logic. Well, it doesn't always go up in a line. It has its ups and downs. It's very jagged, but it's stair-stepped. Anyways, my whole point is, even though I'm shorting, quote unquote shorting, I'm not really shorting. I'm actually trying to make a gain on the pullback. So as the prices pull back, I'm trying to use the fib line to determine like where a price would hit, and on a quick trade, I make a quick gain. So as the prices were here, I did. I actually originally used this line. This line, I should have used this, but it wasn't much of a difference. I did make a limit order on the Chinese exchange here at this price, which is what, 1990 and 60, 1990 and 60 cents, which it did hit amazingly, like to the almost to the T. I'm sorry, this is not it. Actually, mine was a little bit higher, but it still hit. And it pulled back, and as soon as it pulled back above this fib line, I made my gain. I made my gain in Chinese money, but the whole point is to make a gain to eventually buy that gain into Bitcoin. And so what I'm really doing is I'm trying to gain enough money on this downtrend or the price that's moved down. Let me see here. I'll try. Okay, so I'm trying to gain enough money or Bitcoin. Now, I tried it with Bitcoin here, trying to make a gain in Bitcoin on shorting, but unfortunately the price keeps going down. So I'm turning to a different strategy to mitigate some of the price going down, and that is to make long shorts. Basically, I am trying to pick based on, and this is kind of where the fib has really helped me out, the fib lines, is to pick a place. And it's usually I'm picking like this part of the fib line where it's down here, the 70% range, and I'm basically just saying, okay, I'll put a limit order here, I'll see how it goes. If it hits, that's great, I'll watch it. If it goes back up, as soon as it reaches the next fib line, that's basically where I have my limit sell order or something like that. So either it moves up fast enough where it hits this line, where I'll make my sell, or I put a limit order in, and so it'll just do it automatically. So that's one of the reasons why I'm doing this. The second reason is I am also dollar cost averaging. So if my trade doesn't work out, let's say, for example, I put a limit order in here, and it blows through it, and it goes way past it. Well, first of all, it's only 0.1 Bitcoin. So if I lost anything, I lost a couple dollars, all right? Second thing is it goes into my long-term Bitcoin pile. So I'm just, you know, average costing it as it goes down. And it's a small amount. And as it goes down, the amount of Bitcoin to buy, the amount of dollars or whatever Chinese money to buy 0.1 Bitcoin as the price goes down, becomes cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. And so that's another, I guess benefit of dollar cost averaging. And so there's two things that I'm trying to do to mitigate the decrease in price from obviously from 500. But right now I'm trying to gain as much Bitcoin because I am anticipating a larger, or at least a push up. So after this price movement down, so the price moves up, the price moves down, the price moves up, the price moves down. I'm just going to try to play it that way, and I'm still going to be waiting for that larger movement in price above the 400 or above the 400, above the 400 and the 500. So this new fib line will basically be in play for a very long time. And as you go into it, as you zoom in, this is bid stamp. And I want to make a note here, bid stamp 1 hour, shorter term, of course. You see the price, this is unusual, this unusual spike. There was a spike on all the exchanges, but Bitstamp showed the most spike. I'm not sure what this is all about. I'm assuming this is kind of like, I don't know what it is. I guess someone made a mistake, or maybe someone thought this was a breakout because there was a line going through here and it could have showed a breakout, but obviously it didn't. This was unusual. It's a very long wick. It doesn't play with the other exchanges, so I'm not sure what happened here. But even on Bitstamp, you can see that it does play within this certain price here, and it's moving around within these ranges in the fib line. So there's something you can do. And by the way, the price is continuing to somewhat go down, although this is a little delayed from here. Oh, there it is. Okay. So okay, it looks like it just took some time for all these to catch up. But anyways, you know, it's going to be interesting to see what happens. So far it's broken down again. And this, let me just go back to the regular BitPhoenix that I'm used to. So I think it's just trying to push above this fib line right here. As you can tell right here, it's having a really hard time pushing up. And so it's going to obviously break down because it hasn't gone up. Well, I want to see how long or if it comes close. It looks like it is coming close to this. If it breaks that, then you're back to 300 because there's another support, which is the longer support. And it may just break down to 100 again and move up. And so we'll see. At some point with this amount of pullback and this amount of retracement, at some point it does has to push up again. And so that's what I'm waiting for. So that's why I'm trying to make all my little gains that I can in either US dollars or bits. And as time gets closer, and I'll go back to the 1 hour, as time gets closer where I really want to make my move is not now, obviously, not after massive price, the big sell-off right here. But I want to move. Closer to this point right here. So that's what I'm really waiting for. So we got a price movement and it moved down. So now that we got a price movement and it's moved down, that's the wrong one. Let's see what time we have now. It took a little while to make a price move on this. It took all of Saturday and finally into Sunday morning to make a move. So as soon as it just kept going and going, at one point the line actually moved from here, and then this, I thought this was a breakout, and I wanted to make sure it was above this fib line. But as the price moved up, it also moved down. And I noticed something very interesting, that there's the line. It also touched the bottom. So there was a fib line that came in here that kind of touched the bottom. And I'll show you. And I thought that was interesting. I knew then that there might be a chance of a breakdown. But let's see if I can draw this out and you all can see what I was talking about. When you see something strange happen, see right here, this particular line. So I saw this. There's my move that I did. So I made my gain here, and I left that as a high mark, and I was seeing it, and it looked like it was just about to push up, and it looked like it was, and it didn't. But what I did notice that it did drop and hit this as support line, which is not a when your support line is a downtrending line, that's not a good sign. So as I saw it just going sideways forever, I knew that the chance of pushing up higher diminished over time. It just seemed like this was happening with, let me see, let me put that line in there. Leave that line in there. Okay. And it's doing the same thing right here. So it just goes sideways forever and ever, and then all of a sudden at a certain point in time it just drops. And then same thing, almost the same pattern. You see that little it's kind of arches along and then drops, arches along and then it just drops. But I think this is a little different. It's not as dramatic. I don't think it's going to be dramatic. We're not going to see I don't think we're going to see another one of these moving down below 300. I don't think so, but only time will tell. Anyways, let me zoom back in, and so that's what I noticed. And as I saw this, it's probably trending down within this wave of these two lines here. Seems like it's magnifying until it hits this point. So, anyways, let me get that out of there, and let me just go back to talking about this. So, my point is, so I'm making all these fiat gains for one reason only, and that's I'm gonna wait until we get closer to a point where I think that there's a really good potential for making a push higher. And not only is it push higher, but I'm not gonna really make my buy until I get confirmation. One of those confirmation is that it finishes and stays above this fib line, which is at 343.32. So that's the other confirmation that I'm looking for to have this price go back up. So I'm just going to go ahead and continue to play around with this and just kind of make my gains either in Bitcoin or in fiat currency to later buy into Bitcoin when I think it's going to burst upwards. So anyways, this concludes this episode. Sorry if it's a long video. A lot has happened this week, so anyways, feel free to like, dislike, leave a comment or a video response. Until next time, stay tuned. Bye.